So let's start. Thank you all of you for joining the session in time, and we will keep welcoming the people as they keep joining, and they can join the session in the middle also. In the middle of the session, if you feel that session is really going wonderful and it is so good, my partner should listen, my friends should listen, please start calling them and ask them to join the session. So we welcome all of you from the team of Umang. So myself, Dr. Swati Gadkar, I welcome all of you for the 10th session of Umang. And today we have speaker Dr. Bhushan Shukla. Dr. Bhushan Shukla, can you just wave the hand for us? Yes, thank you, Dr. Bhushan. So he is there with us, and he's going to give us some tricks and trades for actually good parenting. I welcome all of you. You all are lovely parents. I completely agree with that, and I really acknowledge your commitment for becoming still better parents for your children. So can we acknowledge ourselves for being such wonderful parents and still want to learn more and more? Please start acknowledging ourselves. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Your presence is precious. So I welcome all of you on behalf of Umang. So what is Umang? Umang is it's a very dear platform for me. So this is started by my dear friend, Dr. Gauri Saroj. Gauri, please wave your hand. Please raise your hand. Thank you so much. Thank you to Gauri. She has a huge contribution to the humanity and for the doctors. And along with her, most of the people from her community doctors have joined this platform very willingly. And we have conducted a lot of sessions which we are dealing every day in our life. And especially being the doctor parents, today we are here for the parenting session for doctors. But of course, welcome non-doctors also. So you will find a lot of our friends also, those who are joining the session. So this was started as a project in Self-Expression Leadership Program. It is one of the program in Landmark Forum. And like super duper program where we actually learned the life. And from that, she has come up with this program. And thank you so much, Gauri, for enrolling all of us to be here, the part of this. So I acknowledge all the founder members of Umang who has built this online program. And this is a medicos who has started this Zeals with the Healers. And it is started with all enthusiasm. So it is a space for rejuvenation, interaction, self-expression, appreciation, inspiration, motivation, and listening. So thank you for joining this space. So let us invite our today's speaker, Dr. Bhushan Shukla. He is a MD, DNB psychiatrist, MRCP in child and adolescent psychiatry. Dr. Shukla is trained in psychiatry in India and in UK. Since 2000, he was worked to prevent the child sex abuse. And Dr. Shukla's training program of Know, Go, and Tell in prevention of child abuse was featured in Amir Khan's Satyameva Jayate. And this was adopted by various NGOs and government. So Dr. Shukla has been a relentless advocate of mental health as important component of overall health being and well-being. So he works with the various schools, colleges, family court, juvenile justice system to provide his services. So in addition to his private practice, Dr. Shukla also conducts the parenting workshops. So can we welcome Dr. Shukla? So before starting the session, I like all of you to do an exercise. You all are ready? So exercise is that, yeah, what we all know about the parenting. Consider that is in a cup. Everything is fulfilled. Whatever we know, the exercise is to empty it. Just empty that. Make your cup empty. Now start listening in completely different way what Dr. Bhushan is going to tell us about the parenting. All over to you. Dr. Bhushan, thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Swati, for that wonderful start. As they say, a good start is half done. So now my job is a lot more easy. Hi, friends. Thanks a lot for sparing your Saturday evening to become even better parents than what you already are. I have divided this talk into two halves. I have promised myself that I'll finish speaking in 30 minutes, which is half of the total time, and will leave remaining half to answer your questions. That's our plan. So first half, I'm going to discuss a few points which specifically involve doctors. And in second half, we are going to talk about what we can do about it in brief. Right at the beginning, what I want to point out is that we spend pretty much entire life in medical education. Okay, though my generation of doctors started studying for their medical college or their entrance exams towards the end of 11th standard, and getting good marks in 12th standard was enough, it is no more so. Within a few years of me joining medical college, I joined MBBS in 1990. Within few years of me joining medical college, the entrance examinations became everything, and kids have started studying for it from 8th standard onwards. So those of us who are doctors today have spent a huge amount of time actually studying in a very focused way. On top of that, you have ruthless 5.5 years of medical college. Though all of us kind of romanticize those 5.5 years now that we are safely past that problem, while it was going on, it wasn't that easy. After that, we had 3 years or 5 years of residency, depending on your postgraduate branch and fellowships and all of that. And we all know how it goes, particularly in government colleges, how difficult this time can be. Medicine actually shapes our personality because we are pretty much adolescents, just leaving our childhood behind when we join medical colleges. And when we actually start practice, or by the time we have children, we have spent that entire time in between in medical education, which has a way of shaping people's personality and affecting their thought process. It doesn't leave us normal. Though we look like other people, there are some almost permanent changes that happen in our brain and that shape us. So first, I want to talk about these changes. What do these changes actually mean to us, and what do they do to parenting? And why I bring this up is I'm going to point out 5 specific thought patterns that are developed in doctors, which are absolutely opposite to what is needed for parenting. Now, this is the challenge that we are dealing with, that our instinct, which makes us a good doctor, actually makes us a difficult parent. So these 5 things which make us fantastic, successful, good, Indian, intelligent doctor actually become our handicap when it comes to becoming parents. So let us look at these 5 things first, because what has happened is that over last 1.5 years, most of the doctors have suddenly realized that there is life beyond medicine. I am married to an intensive care specialist who has looked after COVID ICU for 1.5 years. So we all know how our priorities have changed and how vulnerable we all feel. Before I start, let me just get a feedback from Dr. Swati. Is the slide visible?
Yes, it is.
Great. Okay, so let us start with our first handicap. Doctors are essentially post hoc specialists. What does that mean? That means we come into picture after things have gone bad. Nobody ever asks us, except probably obstetricians, to intervene before things go bad. Okay, there is almost nobody who does regular health checkup from early childhood and continue that well into their adulthood. So we always are brought into picture after things have gone wrong. What does this mean? That means that for whatever 20, 50, 100 patients a day, we are involved after things have gone wrong, and we can identify what went wrong. This kind of complicates our life view, because we only see things that have gone bad. There could be hundreds of people out there, thousands, millions of people out there who are overweight, who are not doing their diet, who are not exercising. And many of us also belong to that category, who live absolutely fine life without any problem at all. But we always see people who have landed into complications because of their lifestyle or whatever. And that is why we become post-op specialists. But we start assuming that everybody with those factors must be having a bad time. So this is something important to remember. Second is that we are intensely competitive. No matter what we say, no matter what we talk about life, work, balance, etc., there are no people who are more competitive, no profession that is more competitive than doctors. And it is not just about how big my practice is than the others. It is about the things that we gather, which show our success. You know, may it be jewelry, may it be clothes, may it be the cars, size of consulting room, number of attachments, whatnot. Doctors are crazy competitive. I remember one of my friends telling me that if there is a competition to go and kill yourself, I think doctors will line up to show how I can kill myself better than any other doctor. Okay, that is the joke going about us in the general public. So this competitiveness, which makes us better doctors and better students, is one quality that we have imbibed over a period of time. And it is very clear that this is going to be a handicap if you want to be a happy parent. Third is that we are very poor listeners. All of us are aware about one report, which is Bore Committee report or Bore Committee report, which was submitted to Government of India around independence. Okay, it talks about medical education and medical services, healthcare services, facilities in India. And that report itself said that doctors do not give more than a few seconds to patients. Now, these things have changed over a period of time, but still, I don't think except psychiatrists, any other person's consultation, any other doctor's consultation goes on beyond half an hour. It doesn't work that way. In fact, most of us, even Western doctors, interrupt their patient within first 45 seconds and start asking direct questions or start telling them something. So we are essentially poor listeners. And this is exactly opposite of what children need. We are trained to be poor listeners. Those of us who are trained in busy medical colleges, busy OPDs know that we have only few minutes to see each patient. This has become our reflex. We try to come to a diagnosis within first few seconds of that patient walking in into the room and sitting down in the chair, but we still want to ask a few questions. That makes us really, really poor listeners. Fourth, which is similar to point one, that we are overestimators of risk. Doctors will invariably overestimate the risk. They will tell how things can go wrong, but they will not say the probability of this happening is 2%, 5%, or 10%. Okay, they underestimate the risk only when it comes to complications. Okay, when it comes to benefits or when it comes to complications of other people's actions, we always overestimate the risk. And that is how the kind of mood that we are always in, the famous Marathi saying, the famous Marathi sentence, which is said by all the parents to their kids, is that if you don't study, you will have to sweep the streets. Now, I know that a BMC sweeper earns something like 30,000 rupees a month. And when I was a resident, and forget resident, even in first few years as a consultant in Pune, I was not earning that much money. So probably being a sweeper in BMC at the age of 18, if you can get the job, probably puts you in better financial footing than becoming a doctor. But there you go. Parents will always overestimate this risk. And the fifth and the most important thing is that we are always in the position of authority where we give advice. Okay. So this reflects that where 50 people, 100 people a day are taking my advice, listening to me, not contradicting me, contributes to my personality. It makes me look at my own opinion in a specific way, which is the opinion of authority. I don't like to be contradicted. I don't like other people telling me contrary things. I don't like people disobeying me. I want people to follow my advice and live accordingly. So these are five most important points that I see as a doctor that have become part of my personality because of my busy training as an Indian doctor. And these will become my handicaps when I become a parent. What medical colleges don't teach us, the most important thing is happiness. I think this post-COVID, or we can call it post-COVID now, this post-COVID talk is all about happiness, right? We all doctors have suddenly realized how fragile life is, how complicated it can be. And now we are searching happiness, which is a great thing. If COVID has brought that to us, then we must be thankful to COVID. Medical colleges don't tell us about happiness. They don't tell us about what really matters in life. There is no discussion, never, ever any discussion about what matters in life. I remember that in my entire medical college, the most important lecture that I attended was the very first lecture in my medical college, in which professor of anatomy and professor of gynecology, both of them came together and advised us about contraception. Right on the very first day of medical college, when our parents were also invited for that lecture. Parents were absolutely shocked that what is going to happen to my kid. But our professor of gynecology, Dr. Mrs. Mahindale at that time, not only advised about female contraception, but she also went on the record to say this in public. In case you get pregnant, please come to us. We will give you full confidentiality and we will help you in whatever needs to be done. Don't be afraid. Don't explore any shadow or shady practices. You know, this kind of support was probably the most important thing that medical students who were leaving their home for the first time needed to hear. But this was never repeated anywhere else in about 12 years of my medical training, either in India or in England. Also, medicine doesn't teach us to take a long-term view of things. We are so busy preventing immediate complications or near-term complications that we don't look at long-term at all. So these three important things in life, medical colleges don't teach us. So that is the first half of the talk, as I promised you, our handicaps as doctors. So let's move on to second stuff. You all know that life is like cricket. There is a batsman, there is a bowler, there are fielders, and then there is an umpire, right? So as a parent, you're essentially a batsman. Your job is to protect those wickets and get as many runs as possible in that particular inning, but you have to protect that wicket. Now, I meet a lot of doctors, a lot of parents, but particularly doctors who are very proud of their parenting personality. They said, this is the kind of person I am, and this has worked for me, so it must work for my child as well. This is a bit like saying that this is the way I play cricket. This is the way I bat. Now, any doctor knows that any batsman taking such a strong stand is bound to be absolutely useless for the team. Because how you want to bat or how you should bat should be dictated by your position in the batting lineup, need of the team at that point of time, the pitch, the bowler, the crowd, lot of things matter. So a batsman who has multiple skills and can change his style accordingly is the real good batsman, or now as they are called, the batter. Because now we have wonderful female teams playing cricket equally well, or maybe even better. So it's not a batsman anymore, it's a batter. All right. So a batter who has a plethora of styles is the real batter, not someone who says that no matter what, I hit the ball very hard. They are bound to lose their wicket very quickly. So what matters is your parenting style, not your parenting personality. Style is something that is changeable according to need. So what are the major styles? They are rated on two dimensions. One is demandingness and second is permissiveness or responsiveness. Okay, so medicine, particularly psychiatry, has this way of taking normal English looking words and giving them very different meaning. So when we say a word, it has a very different meaning than what normal people say. For example, everybody who speaks English or even Marathi or any Indian language uses ego as a word denoting arrogance. So it's a very negative word. But in psychology, where it originally came from, it's a very positive word. It talks about strength of personality to manage conflicts. All right. So same here, demandingness and responsiveness. These are two qualities. Demandingness is where parents clearly delineate what are required things from children. They also give a clear feedback to children, and they give adequate support to fulfill those demands in direct action. That is demandingness. They insist or they expect a certain type of behavior from their children. Remember, it is behavior, it is not outcome. All right, and they are fully supportive of whatever is needed to do that. Second parameter is responsiveness. Is they respond to children's needs, not demands, but needs. Let me give you an example. Imagine, now this is more common for lady doctors here. You've had a long day and you are going back near dinner time or probably past dinner time. You have a small 3-year-old child at home or 2-year-old child at home. You're very eager to meet your child because you have spent the whole day away. Okay, you may have talked to them on a video call 2 or 3 times in the day, but now you're really eager to meet them in person. There you bring the doorbell, you go in, your child comes running to you, you pick up your child, and the child starts getting really angry at you. They scratch at your face, or they try to slap you or be very angry with you, and they say, why did you come home? Go back to hospital. Now, here is the difference between father and mother. Usually a father will respond to the demand of the child and get very angry. He'll say, ki, are, mera important meeting tha, tere liye chhod ke aaya hun. OPD, I have started closing it earlier because I want to spend some time with you. And here I am back at home trying to meet you, and you are an angry child asking me to go back to my work. And father will feel very insulted. But a mother knows what the child is saying. The mother says, I missed you too, sweetheart. I love you. And she captures the emotion of the child. She captures the emotion that this 2-3-year-old is saying, that you spent the whole day away from me. I really missed you. I am so angry that you spend more time at work than spending that time with me. Why don't you go back to your work? So his words, the child's words, and child's emotional need is pointing in exactly opposite direction. But a good parent will respond to the need and not the demand. This is something very important. So parents who are highly demanding and highly responsive as well become authoritative parents. Now, let me tell you, it is told to parents again and again that you should not be demanding. That is completely wrong. Whoever told you that has probably never raised children. We need to be demanding. Our expectations must be very clear about behavior. And why is this important? Because if we keep telling children all the time that I don't expect anything from you, I don't expect anything from you, to fail ho gaya to bhi chalega, etc., etc., the child is going to get an impression that here is my parent, who's the most important person in my life, and is constantly telling me that I don't expect anything from you. Maybe that is because I am such a lousy person that they are trying to keep their expectations really low because I'm not capable of performing anything at all. It is important to tell the children that we do expect good things from you, and we are happy to support you all the way in that. What is wrong is expecting a specific outcome. I expect you to study for 2 hours every day. I expect you to be prepared for exam. I expect you to try and answer all the questions in your exam to the best possible ability. What I do not expect, or what I do not demand, is 100% marks. There is a big difference between these two demands. So a demanding parent, a good demanding parent, demands behavior, whereas a bad demanding parent demands outcome. So when parents are demanding, but very low on responsiveness, they become autocratic, like income tax department. Very demanding, but very little response to our needs. Okay, they become autocratic parents. Parents who are neither demanding, but highly responsive, are permissive parents. They give the children whatever they want, whatever their needs are, whatever their demands are, whatever their fantasies are. They do not discipline their children. They do not keep their word. They just threaten the children, but never actually do anything at all. These are permissive parents. And then there is one bunch of parents who are neither demanding nor responsive. They are uninvolved parents. None of them are likely to be here today spending their Saturday evening with me. So we are not talking about uninvolved parents here at all. Okay. Another thing that you need to remember is most parents want to be loved by their children. When I ask them, what do you want from children? How do you want your children to feel about you? Parents usually say that I want my child to love me. Now, for God's sake, nobody knows what love is. right from Shakespeare or maybe even from Vedas and Upanishads, everybody has tried to define love. Nobody knows what love is in practical terms. Okay? Lot of parents say that I want my child to like me. Lot of them say that I want my child to be afraid of me. But the funny thing in this parent-child relationship is that the flow of relation is very strange. From parents' side, there is this immense responsibility that we feel towards our children. So what should be the other end? What should children feel about it? Ideally, it should be respect. I want my child to respect me. They may not love me every moment of their life. They may not even like me. And I don't want them to be afraid of me. But I definitely want my child to feel respect about me. And the respect, my dear friends, is a long-term prospect. It is your pension fund. You keep depositing in it every month, every day, but you reap the benefits only when you retire. So respect is not shown on a day-to-day basis. Respect is something that comes to you very late. But as a parent, the most important emotion I want my child to feel for me is respect. It is all right if they don't like me, but they must respect me. And children are born with respect. You have to remember that in this relationship, respect is a built-in software. It actually gets damaged as we go on because of our parental behavior. So what are the things that damage respect? Okay, let's look at them. First is constant giving of advice. We as doctors know that unless somebody pays for the case paper, sits in front of us and actually lets us advise them or ask for advice or pays for advice, that advice given is totally wasted. You know, people ask for our advice everywhere. Even when we go for a funeral, a chap standing next to you will tell you a medical query and ask for your advice, but they never follow that. So this giving of advice without desperate need, without asking for it, is total waste, and it definitely reduces respect. Use of sarcasm is a sure shot way of losing respect, because though it feels great to be sarcastic, it really hurts at the receiving end. So sarcasm is like a nuclear bomb. The plane feels great, the plane feels light that they have dropped the bomb, but where the bomb lands, it really hurts. So use of sarcasm makes the other person feel stupid, little, and ineffective. And anybody who makes us feel like that will not have our respect. We all know that from our experience of medical college teachers, who we respect and who we do not. Nasty people, we don't respect them at all. Third part is emotional blackmail. You know, the Nirupama Roy kind of thing. And it's not just mothers. I have seen tons of fathers doing this emotional blackmail. You know, the Walia Koli thing, that I go out and work so hard for this family, I bust my ass and I work so much, I'm going to get a heart attack because I work so hard to provide for you, and look what you do to me. Fathers are very good at sitting down and crying. Okay, so anybody who does emotional blackmail is unlikely to get respect from children. Fourth is disengagement. Lot of parents sulk. I call that parent tantrum. We all are familiar with children's tantrum, but these are parent tantrums. Okay, these are silent tantrums. Child does something wrong or does not obey us, and we go into this shutdown mode. We don't talk to them. We don't make eye contact. We start moving away from them. We don't answer their question or just yes, no syllable. Now, when we use one weapon, we have to be aware that the other party can use the same weapon on us, and can we handle that? When children shut down, when they shut their doors, when they stop talking to us, can we handle that? So if you cannot tolerate a nuclear weapon landing on your land, you should not be throwing nuclear weapons on other countries. It is as simple as that. And anybody who disengages in that way, sure to lose respect. And the last point that I want you to remember is your vision of future. Somehow we doctors feel that we are the most intelligent people on earth, and we know everything that is going to happen about future. Now, if you were that intelligent, how come you are not a billionaire by now? And your children know that. How come your body is not like Salman Khan or Amir Khan? Or your hair are not like Karishma Kapoor or Kareena Kapoor or whoever the latest fancy thing on screen is? Children know that whatever parents say is probably invalid. It is rooted in their own experience of their past. So children are not interested in listening to your vision of future. because they know that nobody knows about future. If anybody, it's going to be them who are going to make future. So use of these five techniques, giving advice, using sarcasm, using emotional blackmail, disengaging from children, and forcing your vision of future on them again and again, is a sure shot way of losing respect of your children. So there is this Marathi shairi that I'm going to read out. Probably some of you have heard of Bhausaheb Patankar, who used to live, write wonderful Marathi shairi. He says that Jato tithe upadesh amma sangato koni tari, kirtane sari kade, sohi kade Jnaneshwari. Kalaji amucha hitachi yevadi vahu naka, jau sukhe narakata ami, tithe tari yevu naka. This is what I hear from children again and again about overbearing parents and their experience of parenting. They're ready to go to hell if their parents will not follow them and keep advising them all the time. Written in a very sarcastic manner, but like good shayari, it definitely carries that meaning. So what we should be doing? We should be offering practical help, not advice. If you want your child to wake up at 6 o'clock in the morning, unless you have very obedient and very well-behaved children, you need to wake up with them and sit with them. You don't need to do math, but you need to sit with them. Tell them that, okay, I will be here with you. I'll help you. Okay, I'll sit there and read my book. I'll do my study, but I will keep you company. The child says, Dad, I want to go and run. I want to achieve this. You can offer, I'll go with you. I'll help you. Let's see how what I can do for you. So instead of giving advice and planning things for them, it is important to be their training partner. That is what really matters. Children are not interested in your advice. They have good enough intelligence to make plans on their own. Our job is to be with them and help them execute that plan, not just try to make a better plan. This is something really important. So the simple take-home message from me to you is emotional climate of parenting is really important. Trusting, comfortable, non-dramatizing climate helps children calm down faster. Action is more important than words. Please remember that mute parents also bring up children really well. So your ability to talk is not important. Your ability to do is what really counts. Do what is needed. Do what is appropriate. Do it with courage. Don't be afraid of your children. Constantly fearing that, oh my God, they will stop loving me if I do this, does not matter. If it is correct, if it is appropriate, then show the courage and do it. And that is how it works. So thank you and good luck for parenting. Those of you who want to read a little bit more can follow me on my blog at docbhushan.com or follow me on Twitter at docbhushan.com. Thank you very much for this opportunity. Thanks, Umang. I'm very happy to take your questions if we are ready now.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bhushan, for such a lovely presentation and guidance. Gauri called me, she said, there is a session on parenting. I said, kuch kaam nahi karta teenager ke saath, mujhe nahi aana hai. And I just went on saying, then she said, why don't you only host the session? Come, let's see what is there, discover together. So this is how we have started. And it's really, I got the gist. It is, I have done the seminar. I have done the training part. So I am the one who's going to change. Many a times it happens that I take the seminar, I take the advice and go and apply it on the children. And I want them to change. But I get it. The gist is that I need to change. It is like what you have created is a fantastic, how we can be the fantastic support system for our children. How can we get through the communication? So thank you so much for this talk. Let us ask for the questions. Please come up with the questions.
Yeah, Swati.
Anyone with the questions? Please unmute and ask.
So there is a question, Dr. Bhushan.
Yep.
How to balance between work and parenting for single parents?
Yeah, so for single parents, the advice is, again, I must fall back on Bollywood. You know, let's look at Munna Bhai MBBS movie. जब जिंदगी कम हो तो डबल जीने का, राइट? दैट इज व्हाट अप्लाइज टू सिंगल पेरेंट. सो मेनी टाइम्स सिंगल पेरेंट आर ऑन द साइड ऑफ बीइंग मोर नाइस टू द चाइल्ड बिकॉज दे फील दैट आई हैव ऑलरेडी क्रिएटेड द हैंडीकैप, और अनफॉर्चुनेटली दिस हैज हैपेंड दैट चाइल्ड हैज ओनली वन पेरेंट, सो आई हैव रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी टू लव द चाइल्ड. इट वर्क्स द अदर वे अराउंड. If you are a single parent, for whatever reason, your first job is to make sure that your child becomes your partner in action. So good discipline from early on is important. Shifting responsibility to the child and giving them appropriate positive feedback with them, that is absolutely important. And not feeling guilty is absolutely the essence. That is really true. Second thing is what you have asked about balance of work and parenting. I think obviously as a single parent, you may have more financial responsibility than a couple. So finding partners in parenting is really important if you are a single parent. It is true for all parents, but particularly for single parents, try to generate parenting support network for your child. So your parents, your friends, your neighbors, whoever you trust should also play a big part in your child's life. Your child going over, forming those relations. Many times single parents feel more insecure and they try to be everything for that child. They even block the child forming other relationships. That is not true. You cannot be the sole caretaker of the child. Let other adults get involved. They will have their own way of parenting your child. Don't try to manipulate that. Let it be. Let the child have all these experiences and the burden on you will be reduced. The extra working hours you need to put will be compensated by these co-parents who are all around you. This is important.
Thank you so much. There is one more question which has come up. How to keep the communication on with the children in the adolescent?
So adolescents are definitely a challenging lot for all parents. What works best is not to treat them like children, but to have an adult-to-adult communication. Talking to them not in the condescending child-like tone, but talking to them in adult-like tone, using adult language and giving adult responsibilities, and only gradually giving adult rights. Most of the parents give them full adult rights very quickly, but do not put adult responsibilities. Look at it like getting salary. See, I don't think there is any hospital here in India or anywhere in the world who pays salary before the month starts to their doctors. You don't get salary on 1st of January for January month. If you are lucky, you will get it on 7th. That too with substantial cutting, right? That is how life works. First you do the work and then you get benefit of that. So let children show the ability and then give them freedom, then give them rights. Do not push the right on them. Do not give them freedom and then expect them to handle it appropriately. That usually backfires. So adult-like communication, good understanding, but waiting for them to prove their ability before you give them their rights. That is what works best with adolescents.
Thank you, Dr. Bhushan. There is one more question. With the father away and my boys are throwing more tantrums, how to handle 17-year-old twins?
Lot of boys and even girls are more aggressive towards their mothers. And what mothers require at this point of time is a bit of testosterone. And I say this in a sensitive way. What it means is that mother has to have body language and communication skills of a confident adult. It's not about male or female. There are no requests. Can you please do this? No, it's your duty. You need to do it. So that authority needs to carry in your voice. Somehow our society always tells women to be more loving, more caring, more accommodating, always be nice, make sure that everybody likes you. That is something that is taught to women in our society all the time. So women invariably put away their own respect, their own needs, their own demands, and try to accommodate others. Now, as you see in society, same thing happens in family. A person who does not behave in an assertive way gets walked all over by other people. They will always put their demands, their needs ahead of you and actually expect you to sacrifice and accommodate. This cultural training of our women has to change. You know, we have already 21 years into the 21st century. We cannot work with 18th century image of a woman. So being confident, holding down those guidelines, giving very clear indications and clear instructions to our children, and making sure that they follow it very assertively is important. So bring up that man in you. You know, the traditional male and female role needs to be combined in every man and every woman. We all are Ardhunari Nateshwar now. We do not have a choice. So bring out that Jhansi Ki Rani and Kalika part of you and do whatever is needed.
Thank you. So we have Sheetal Shigaokar here. She wants to ask a question. Yes, Sheetal, please go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am. First of all, thank you so much, sir, for the wonderful session. I'm not from medical background, but I have joined the session, like my BD shared the link with me. I have one little query. Actually, as of now, like we stay in a nuclear family, right? So there are how to raise the children in a nuclear family, because in the joint family, there are grandparents and other family members also, like they can help them to find out the their answers of their questions, right?
Okay, sorry, can you ask the question again? I lost your question.
Like how to handle children in nuclear family? Do we have to be very friendly with them, or do we have to be an adult?
So see, the thing is that as I said right in the beginning, that a single fixed style is not helpful. Depending on age of the child, temperament of the child, demand of the task, the time, the position, we will have to change our styles. We will need to be flexible in that. So there is no one single answer that if you behave this way, the child is going to be all right. If you have to ask yourself a question to guide your behavior, I would say that, am I looking at long-term betterment of my child? This is the first question. Second, am I emotionally responding well, positively to my child? And third question, am I afraid?
Okay.
So if your actions should not be fueled by fear, they should be emotionally appropriate for the child, but they should always look at long-term benefit of the child. Those would be three important questions before you decide on any course of action.
Okay. Okay. So basically, yeah, we have to understand the demand of the situation, right?
Yes, and need of the child.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Sheetal. We have a exactly opposite side question. I'm in a joint family. How to safeguard my 4-year-old boy from the grandparents who are pampering, giving junk food, TV, too many advices, how to be, what to be, what not to be, and how to handle this?
You know, I'm going to come back to this sexist nature of our society again and again. In 20 years of conducting parenting workshops, this question has never been asked to me by any father. This is a question that is always asked by mother, and there is a reason for that. Because no matter what happens to the child, even if a tiny bit goes wrong, people directly blame the mother. As they say in Marathi, hasra mul sagalyancha, radka mul aicha. The moment the baby starts crying, it is handed over to the mother. As long as the baby is happy and playful, everyone is ready to play with the baby. So this kind of unfair responsibility makes women vulnerable for these questions, because grandparents would want to be on the good side of the child. They will do all these things. And then you are told by people like Dr. Shukla that reduce your child's screen time. That's a huge dilemma. My take on that is that for practical problems, we need to find practical answers. Lot of mothers try to shoulder this responsibility of future of the child almost single-handedly, even while living in a joint family. My take is that start outsourcing responsibilities. Sit down with grandparents and ask them that I need help from you. What all responsibilities are you willing to take? Grandmom, will you look after my child's food? So breakfast, lunch, dinner is your job. You decide what he or she should eat and you will feed him that. I will not be around. I will attend my gym session or I'll go out with my friends in the evening when you're feeding dinner because I really need that time for myself. Grandfather, you are supposed to be good in math. I give you math responsibility. Please sit down and teach my child math every day or make sure that they are doing homework every day. Give them named responsibilities and let them do it in their own way. Your grandmother may not give the best diet to the child, but it is better that she takes that responsibility because anyway, once those children are beyond 10 years of age, they don't listen to anybody. So you don't take all the halahal that comes out in this Samudra Manthan and become a daitya for the child. At times, stand at the tail of the Naga and enjoy all the good things that come out of joint family as well. Give named responsibilities, hand over your child and look at cloud parenting. The child doesn't belong to you anyway. It doesn't belong to anybody. Within a few years, they are going to fly away and not look back anyway. So have some fun with them. Hand over responsibilities. Be crafty. Be a little bit devilish.
Thank you for that, creating all this. So we have either Madhur Karwa who wants to ask the question. Dr. Madhur, can you just unmute yourself? Dr. Madhur?
Yes. Hello, sir. I love you for the lecture. I am a pediatrician, but yet I have so many, you know, queries since my child was a newborn. Now she's a 10-year-old. She's good in academics and she's a poetess. She writes. But what is happening is, she's a happy child, no problem. I really do not have any problem. But she doesn't share anything. You know, she keeps everything inside her. She writes a diary. And I admit in front of everyone, ki I have peeped in that diary. She writes so many things. She has got crushes. Also, I had crushes when I was her age, maybe before that. But as a mother, I'm not able to take this. So what's your advice on this?
I don't remember a time in my life when I was not in love with somebody. Okay. Obviously, I got successful only once and I have been holding on to that woman for last 30 years who happens to be my wife. So if children are falling in love, if they're having crushes, first of all, you must pat your own back that you have created a family and environment where children believe that love is a good thing. So if your child is able to love, that means they have experienced love, they see love, they feel love, and they trust in love. So that's a compliment to any parent. All right, that is the first thing that we must remember. Second thing is that about sharing everything. Now this everything sharing is non-existent. Nobody is supposed to share everything. When people start doing that, we label them as manic and put them in psychiatry wards. Who have no ego boundaries and everything that is there in their unconscious or subconscious is coming out as conscious to other people. Give me just 1 second. Something has gone wrong here. So the most important part is that children are not going to tell you the whole thing. Even I'm sure you do not tell the whole thing to anybody. Not even to God. So that is formation of ego boundary, where you start differentiating your private world from the outside world, even from people that you trust. If she's leaving that diary open there for you to read, it is actually a communication diary, or you have told her that you read her diary, right? So she knows that you access it. You said that you...
I have access to the key.
So she knows you have the key. She knows you can read the diary. That means whatever is written there is for your consumption. All right. It is not a secret diary. Probably she has a secret diary somewhere else where she doesn't tell you. It's a hidden folder on her phone or laptop, which you have no access to. You don't even know where it is. So this diary is a communication. So she is trying to tell you things. But what she's saying is that read it and keep it to yourself. I don't want to speak it with you on face, because then you will ask questions and I'll have to answer. I don't want to do that, but I still want you to know it. So your daughter already trusts you. I don't think you should worry at all.
Dr. Amrita, can we ask? Yes, Madhura. Yes, Madhura. Yes, yes, please go ahead.
Sir, I am a pediatrician and I see a lot of patients with anxiety nowadays. You know, in a busy OPD, it is really very difficult to cater to their emotional needs. But if you could just tell me about two things. Teenagers with a lot of anxiety. What can I advise them? I try on my level.
Yeah. Unfortunately, there is no single simple answer. You know, if you're interested, if a lot of pediatricians are seeing this, I'm happy to do a talk for you where we can actually talk about anxiety, because anxiety happens to be a fairly complex topic, and there is no single answer to anxiety. So I'm very happy to do that for your group if you guys are interested. I'm really sorry. This is a essay question. I can't give MCQ answer.
I really do understand. Thank you very much. And I love you for the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Madhur. Dr. Amrita, can I come to you a little later? Because there are 10 times people have asked only one question. How to get rid of this addiction of the mobile and the screen? So let us just ask that.
There is never a parenting session where I can get away without answering this question. Okay, so this is the most frequently asked question. As it happens with all complex questions, the answers are not straightforward. Most important thing to remember is that the guidelines for screen time are very important. 0 to 3 years, zero screen time. 3 to 5 years, half an hour to 1 hour of screen time. Beyond that, screen time should not exceed 2 hours on any given day. And there has to be at least one day which is screen free. I know what you're thinking. You're saying that in these days of online education, how do we manage that? So online education should not be considered as screen time, provided you have installed appropriate softwares and your child is only attending the screen as they would attend real life, and not have two devices to chat at the same time or other windows open to chat at the same time. Online education has to imitate real education. You cannot crosstalk in a class. So you are not allowed to have a chat by the side there. You're not allowed to use a mobile phone while sitting in a classroom. So you cannot have a mobile phone open while you are looking at the screen where your teachers are teaching you. This is important. Second part, now most of you are asking this question because you have crossed that 2 hour limit probably a few years ago itself. So the way it has to happen is that you have to start by creating screen free time at home. And this rule applies to parents as well. Most of the doctor's parents sitting there telling their children that I'm doing work are actually surfing internet and going through their WhatsApp. You know, children also know that. So say 6 o'clock or 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock, whatever, should be the screen switch off time for everybody at home, except grandparents, because they can watch TV in their own room, not in the living room. Okay. And that will be switched on directly at 7 o'clock in the morning. So start by creating a 12-hour zone every day where there is no screen time whatsoever. And then gradually extend that and take it to 2 hours of screen time. A lot of children are going to be unhappy. But I never said, I'll make you happy children. I told you that I'll make you happy parents.
Thank you so much for that clarity. Thank you so much. So yes, Dr. Amrita, please go ahead.
Good evening, Dr. Bhushan. Dr. Amrita Durge here. I'm a general pediatrician from Thane. I have a specific question. Thank you for clarifying most of the doubts that even I had through the previous questions. My specific doubt was, I have a 10 and a half year old. And of course, as being a pediatrician, I do see many children of the same age group. What I have started feeling with my own son and with many other children and parents who share with me is that there is a difficulty in instilling the value of motivation and having response, self motivation and responsibility towards their main job, which is learning, the studying, of course. So studying, I understand studying does happen in many ways, but then there is something which is the basic part of the schooling, which is self-learning, self-studies. So what I have been feeling and finding difficult is how to instill the motivation of my son and similar children, having their self-motivation to get their own job done, and then maybe, you know, seek assistance if they have any difficulties. There are many other distractions that have come up in the past 1.5 years, and screen time has been one of them. But is there any way you have found it the most efficient or most effective way of having the child understand self-responsibility towards studies?
Dr. Amruta, first of all, thanks a lot for asking this question, because this goes right at the heart of the biggest questions that we face as 21st century parents. One thing that parents need to realize is that it is okay to have children getting thoroughly bored. As parents, it is not our job. It is not even the 30th attempt on the agenda that I have to keep my children entertained. Okay, I have outsourced that job to Bollywood. Okay, it's not my job anymore. I spend money on that to whatever their Korean boy bands and girl bands and whatever that is. Entertainment is outsourced to them. BTS. Second part is that entertainment can happen only for certain hours every day. And that typically should not exceed an hour to hour and a half. This needs to be clearly communicated to the child that what you are doing right now is entertainment. If you are playing a computer game, it's entertainment. If you are listening to music, it's entertainment. You are chatting with your friends, that is socialization and entertainment. So putting restrictions on that entertainment time is absolutely important. Children need to get bored, because unless they get bored, they will not be motivated to do anything at all. Not praising senseless, small, and irrelevant achievements. Getting 10 out of 10 in some piddly unit test in maths should not get price of an iPad for a child. Kuch teez nahi mara hai. 10 mark ka exam tha, you attended it, you solved all of them, well done, keep it up, move on. Everything does not need to be compensated in material gains. One more part is that children have to work at home. I don't care if they don't go to school. Education is not my responsibility. Education is their responsibility. Okay? I have studied. I have slogged my ass off for 14 years to become a doctor. I don't need any more education in my life. It's your job. I am earning for myself. I'm looking after my retirement. I am happy to look after you also if you stay in my home and change my diapers when I'm old. But you look after yourself. Your education is your responsibility, not my responsibility. I can only create conditions for that. That has to be my clear stand. You are part of this household. You need to work. You have specific responsibilities. And I'm very proud to say that I have managed to put that in action. You know, starting washing machine, loading dishwasher, unloading that, folding clothes, looking after the dog, looking after grandmother, are all the jobs that are done by my daughters at home. And this is what they have been doing since they were 4 and 5 years old. There is no child young enough or too young to do household work. A 1.5 year old who can walk can definitely carry their own plate and put it in the sink. So parents need to really shape up. We are not Bollywood parents. Wake up every morning, check your bank balance. If it is under 20 crore, wake up your children and get them to work, because they will need to work. All right. So parents need to really give up this hyper responsibility of doing everything for their children and keeping them entertained all the time. When your time is over for the computer, it is over. If the child says, I'm bored, what should I do? How is that my problem? How do you even ask me that question? It's not my problem. You go find out. If not, go to the neighbor's house and do some work for them. You know, I wouldn't take that responsibility at all. And I'll be absolutely shameless about it. I'll be proudly shameless about it. So the first job for parents to solve this problem is to become shameless and clearly shift that responsibility to children at a very, very early age, I would say 4 years.
So according to you, I mean, this may be argued upon by some of the family members as a very Western approach of letting the children have their own responsibility.
Ma'am, what is there as Indian in our life anymore?
No, this is not my opinion. We are living
a Western life.
Yeah.
So it will have to be Western. All of us want our children to go to US, don't we?
Maybe.
Yeah, you just look at Bombay airport check-in counters and see the biggest bags carried in the world are by Nigerian smugglers and Indian university going students. They even take ready-made food from India as if there is no food in US. Right? So if we are gearing up our children for that Western world, we might as well start giving them Western responsibilities. And those parents who talk about Indian values need to remember Lalaye Panchavarshani, Dashavarshani Tadayet, Prapte Tu Shodashe Varshe, Putre Mitram Vadacharet. For 10 years, you need to discipline your children very severely, even going by the most ancient Indian code. Prabhu Shri Ram was sent away with Vishwamitra at the age of 8 years to protect the Yajna from demons. You know, there was no pampering happening for children. Shri Krishna at the age of 5 years was going out with a herd of cows to look after them. He was not given any formal education till he almost became adult. So when we talk about India, are we willing to take ancient Indian responsibilities or are we just going to hide behind that and badmouth Westerners? We need to make our children ready for 21st century by taking responsibility of their own life. My child's life is not my progress record. I am living my life. That is my progress record. My child will make his or her own life. I'll be very happy if they are successful. I'll celebrate that success. I'll stand with them. I'll support them. I will give all the facilities that are possible, but the outcome is not on my progress record.
All right. Thank you so much. I think that clears a lot of dilemma. Thank you.
Cheers. I think we are almost at the end of our time.
Yeah, so there are two questions which have come from the general interactions. Any advice to do and don'ts when the parents say to each other they are staying together only for the children?
The advice is don't stay together for children. Again, let's go back to Ramayana and remember the story of Valmiki. You know, he was a highwayman. Valyakoli was a highwayman. And when he tried to rob Narad, Narad asked him, are your children and are your family who you are making this killing for, will they participate in your sin? And they said no. That was a transformational moment. So children did not ask you to get married. Children did not ask you to procreate. So staying together for children is a completely, and I'm sorry, this is going to sound very harsh. It's a dishonest answer. This will come back and bite you in long term.
Thank you so much. There's one more question. How to interact with children when the parents have a bad day?
So this is exactly where our personality is called to question. This is an opportunity for my child to learn that bad days are part of life. So when I have a bad day, I come back home. Children look at my face and they recognize, Dad, looks like you have had a horrible day. And I say, sweetheart, I'm so happy to come back home because now my bad day is over. I had a terrible bad day. If it is worth sharing without disclosing any patient information or without breaking any confidentiality, I'm happy to tell them that this is what I faced today. And I was really rattled. It took me a lot of time to compose myself. Children need to know that their parents are vulnerable too. I am not there to put up some facade that I always have a fantastic day every day. You know, I'm not a drug addict to have a fantastic day every day after that heroin shot, which lasts for a few minutes. Okay, this is real life. So they need to see that, yes, things can go wrong, but you can handle them. There are ways to do that. And even after your best effort, some things will still be bad, but you will be happy to come home to a loving family. So I need to hug my children. I need to hug my wife and tell them, I had had a terrible day. I'm so glad to be home. That's important.
Beautiful. So thank you so much for answering so many questions and really putting us into, taking out of the dilemma for us and actually giving us a complete clarity where we should stand as a parent. And we definitely work on ourselves and not definitely work on...
You are muted. Dr. Swati, you are muted.
Yeah, sorry. So I said, I'll just come again. I said, we will definitely work on ourselves to have a super interaction with our children or not really put all the bangings on the children so that they will change. So thank you so much. So anybody has got any questions, because we are almost finishing the session. Thank you so much. I can't see any hands raised.
Maybe
so
we can have one more session in that case, because we can't accommodate.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting me. My sincere thanks to Umang, the whole program and the idea, Dr. Swati, and Dr. Prajakta for getting me connected with all of you guys. This is wonderful. Thanks a lot.